Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks again for joining the 2021 Peace and War Virtual Summit at Norwich University in Vermont. My name is Yang Moku. I am Associate Professor of Political Science and Associate Director of Peace and War Center at Norwich University. I'm also serving as an Executive Director for this year's summit. At 1 p.m. today, we addressed a topic of U.S.-China technology race delivered by Dr. Christopher White. And this time, Dr. Ming Cheung at UC San Diego will give another talk on the U.S.-China technology race. The title is Domestic Sources of U.S.-China Technology Security Competition. In this session, Dr. Michael Thunberg at Norwich University will moderate this session. So let me introduce him briefly. Dr. Michael Thunberg is an assistant professor of political science and director of the honors program here, with a research interest that focuses on the American presidency. Specifically, he examines how presidents use unilateral powers and judicial appointments to affect policy. His research focus is echoed in his teaching, ranging from the introductory classes on American government to advanced classes on the presidency and citizenship. Right now, I turn it over to Dr. Thunberg.
Thank you, Dr. Koo, and thank you everybody for joining us today. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Ming Cheung. He is the director of the Institute on Global Conflict and Cooperation, located at the University of California, San Diego in La Jolla. He leads the Institute's Study of Innovation and Technology in China project that examines China's efforts to become a world-class science and technology power. Dr. Cheung is also a professor at the School of Global Policy and Strategy at UC San Diego, where he teaches courses on Chinese foreign and defense policy and Chinese security and technology policy. Dr. Cheung is a longtime analyst of Chinese and East Asian defense and national security affairs, especially defense economic, industrial, and science and technological issues. He is author of Fortifying China, The Struggle to Build a Modern Defense Economy, editor of Forging China's Military Might, A New Framework for Assessing Innovation, and co-editor of The Gathering Pacific Storm, Emerging U.S.-China Strategic Competition in Defense, Technological, and Industrial Development. He was based in Northeast Asia, Hong Kong, China, and Japan from the mid-1980s to 2002, covering political, economic, and strategic developments in Greater China and East Asia as a journalist for the Far Eastern Economic Review from 1988 to 1993, and subsequently as a political and business risk consultant for a number of companies, including PricewaterhouseCoopers. Dr. Cheung has a PhD in war studies from King's College in London, and we appreciate his time and look forward to his talk. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, Dr. Cheung.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Thank you, Yang. Well, it's a pleasure to be able to talk with you about this very important topic. And hopefully you've sort of over the course of the summit the past few weeks, you've been able to sort of get a lot of sort of knowledge and understanding. So what I'm going to be focusing upon in my talk is to look sort of at sort of as the title explains, the domestic sources of this US-China technology and security rivalry, and what is driving that. And I'm particularly focusing on sort of what's going on in China, because I think a lot of the competition, a lot of the dynamics is driven by the leadership of the Chinese paramount leader, Xi Jinping. But of course, it's the development process that China is in, it also plays a very important role. Next slide, please. So in looking at sort of the US-China rivalry itself, at the very heart of what we see that's been going on, especially in the last couple of years, is at the heart of this rivalry is a technology security nexus. Can someone move the slide to the next slide, please? If not, then you'll just have to listen to what I have to say. So
I'm working on it right now. It's the slide transferred and moved on our screen, but it's not showing up on the webinar. So we're working on changing it for you.
Okay. So technosecurity is at the heart of the great power competition that we're seeing between the US and China these days. And what I mean by technosecurity is this relationship between sort of science, technology, and innovation, and how sort of countries like China, but also the US, are reaping sort of their technological capabilities, their economic development, and transforming that into military and strategic capabilities. And so when we try to look at sort of this technosecurity great power competition, it's very important to understand what are the domestic drivers of this. And so what I'm going to be focusing upon is to describe to you what I define as the Chinese technosecurity state. It's like, what has China under Xi Jinping since he's come to power in 2012? What has he built? What are the components of this technosecurity state that leverages the economic development, the science and technology and innovation capabilities, and then turns that into state power itself? Then there's this notion of what is the national security state, because the technosecurity state has these different components. There's a technology part of it, there's a national security part, and then there's a military strengthening part to it. And also a fourth part, which has come up quite often, is the notion of military civil fusion. How does the civilian and defense portions of the economy, of the innovation system, are increasingly integrated together? And then at the end, I'll try to provide sort of a framework, because while China is a technosecurity state, we can also sort of define the US as in a similar fashion itself. You're already there with the slide. So China is under Xi Jinping is what I define as a technosecurity state. And a technosecurity state is a security maximizing state that builds its power and its prestige on a capable economic and technological foundation. And Xi Jinping, since coming to power, and this is a part of his sort of his notion of the China dream, is that he sees sort of China's rise to become sort of a world leader, whether it's sort of today, in 10 years, in 20 years' time, or his goal is by 2050, that it's the technological foundations that will transform China from catching up to challenging the US for global supremacy itself. And so the notion that sort of technosecurity is front and center is very much sort of clearly shown in Xi Jinping's sort of policies, in his strategic visions, his grand strategy, and in a number of various areas itself. So the goal for a technosecurity state that China is now is, how can the Chinese state as effectively and efficiently as possible have a balanced and coordinated relationship between national security, technological innovation, and economic development? How can they make these different parts of the Chinese system very integrate and work well together? Because in the past, whether sort of in the 1950s and 1960s and 1970s under Mao Zedong, China was much more focused on militarization. And then sort of from the 80s and 90s to the 2000s onwards, China was more about economic development under sort of Deng Xiaoping and Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao. And so Xi Jinping wants to do is to bring the military, the strategic and the security portions of the state that were sort of on the back burner as economic development was the prime focus amongst his predecessors to try to lift that up. So that makes it that that economic development, national security, technological innovation, military modernization, they are all sort of well and truly balanced and interconnected. Next slide. So when you look at sort of what Xi Jinping and the regime around him, they've been very, very busy since Xi Jinping came to power. So he's been in charge now for about sort of 9 years. It's since sort of the late 2012 at the 18th Party Congress. And in that time, there's been a number of key strategies, key policies that if you look at, if you try to understand what is going on in China, these are the key elements that you should pay attention to. A national security strategy that sort of came out in 2015, 2016, an innovation-driven development strategy that is try to define what sort of the country's overall sort of development model should be. That came out in the spring of 2016. And then there's this sort of what we call sort of military strengthening in the new era. That is sort of Xi Jinping's grand strategy for military modernization. And that's sort of been rolling out for the last few years. And then the fourth strand is this notion of military-civil fusion. How do you sort of have the civilian and the military portions of the economy work and fuse increasingly closer together? So that are the four strands that I'll be touching upon. Next slide. And this is sort of a visual demonstration that is like that when you look at what is going on, a key takeaway is that this is a very statist model, right? That this is a very sort of state-led, top-down model. And Xi Jinping is very much sort of at the very top. And so there's a sort of grand design, and there's all these different components itself. So this top-down state-led model is something that China sort of sees as a fundamental strength in its competition with the U.S., while the U.S. is tries to approach this from a very different way. Next slide. So I'll look at one of the key components is the national security component. Next slide. So when Xi Jinping came to power in 2013, he inherited sort of a China that was relatively benign, that was focused overwhelmingly on economic development. And although it was sort of becoming increasingly assertive, China was still very much had good relations with countries around it, and the U.S.-China relationship was still sort of relatively sort of in good shape. But Xi Jinping came to power, and no one expected this, that he had a very, very different view, that there was a hard shift to national security itself, that instead of seeing a benign a benign external and domestic environment, Xi Jinping said, well, we're under threat, that China is under threat domestically. There's all these problems, such as ideological corruption, political corruption, economic corruption, that is really eaten away at the grip of the Communist Party itself. And also, this is combined with what's going on externally, with threats to China's sovereignty, territorial integrity, and other facets of China's external security and environment. Next slide. And so what Xi Jinping said was that China's sort of security is under threat, is under severe threat. I mean, there was a statement at one of the meetings that he was presiding over in 2014, where he said that China faces the most complex security challenges in its history. which is quite a statement to make, given that it was sort of facing war and peace with the Soviet Union and the US during the Cold War. And the reason, as I said, is because Xi Jinping redefined what national security meant for China, that it wasn't just about sort of traditional sort of security threats like military or cyber or those types of things. It's like he increasingly defined national security in political terms. It's about sort of the ideological purity of the party. It's about sort of making sure that the Communist Party is very, very much in charge. And so what Xi Jinping did is that national security became increasingly linked in to restoring sort of the power and the pride and the stability and centrality of the Communist Party. In control around the country and externally. And this is why we see then sort of this very hard turn in national security, whether it's to deal with what's going on in Hong Kong or in Xinjiang, or in terms of maintaining tight surveillance control within the country, purging party cadre of corruption, but also of political sort of malfeasance, etc. So a lot of this reconceptualization of national security focuses on non-traditional political as well as emerging threats that comes from very different core quarters. So it's a very, very different non-traditional approach to national security. Next slide. I mean, there's a number of reasons why sort of there was this hard national security turn. Xi Jinping sort of pays particular attention, and he in his speeches he goes back and says, well, one of the reasons why China is in trouble is because look at what happened to the Soviet Union when it collapsed at the end of the 1980s. Also, Xi Jinping was sort of facing sort of some serious political infighting as he tried to get to power itself. So there was a number of major reasons why there was this national security turn. Next slide. So one of the important sort of characteristics of this national security shift and the rise of this techno security state is that the Xi Jinping regime, they very much see that there's a very tight relationship between internal and external security, that what goes on domestically has ramifications from the outside, and what is going on sort of in terms of external security issues also links in on the inside. So for example, what's going on in Hong Kong? So we've seen, especially in the last year, there's been a major clampdown using national security legislation that the Chinese authorities have done in Hong Kong to prevent democratic efforts taking place there. And one of the rationales that the Chinese say is that while this is taking place within Hong Kong, it's being done by hostile foreign forces, that there's increasingly that these foreign forces, which is implicitly linked to the West, the US, and its allies, are trying to undermine and overthrow the Chinese regime because of its because they disagree with the political nature of the Chinese regime. And so what we see is that this US-China sort of rivalry is increasingly ideological. It's increasingly political itself. And that what that is this really adds to the structural dimensions. When it's sort of up until the last few years, a lot of the US-China rivalry was about power politics, was about China's increasing power. But a lot of this is also now normative, that there's the ideological part, the political dimensions. Next slide. And so what we've seen is as part of this national security, there's been a major effort to ramp up the national security state, the national security capabilities itself. Next slide. There's been establishment of new institutions like a Central National Security Commission, building up and remaking of the national security apparatus, boosting the public security, the paramilitary, developing a comprehensive and high-tech surveillance apparatus. So the national security capabilities of the Chinese state is increasingly far stronger than in terms of the political and internal threats that it faces. Next slide. And so this is an organization chart to show how widespread and pervasive and very different, very modern and comprehensive this national domestic portion of the national security state is. Next slide. So now look at these other two parts itself, the military strengthening and the military civil fusion part itself. Next slide. So as I mentioned, a key part of the techno security state is to enhance China's military capabilities itself. And Xi Jinping, since he came to power, he's really relished and embraced one of his key jobs. He wears a number of hats. He's the party general secretary, he's the state president, but one of the hats that he pays most attention to is as commander in chief. In Chinese communist parlance, he's the chairman of the Central Military Commission. And what Xi Jinping has done in his 8-9 years in charge is that he's defined his grand strategy for developing what he calls turning Chinese military power from being big, in which China is very large, but there's not much quality to it, to try to make Chinese military power strong. So this is the emphasis on military strengthening itself. So it's how does China be able to develop the capabilities to turn the PLA into a world-class military? And so this is the focus on technology and innovation. Next slide. And so under Xi Jinping, he's laid down a very clear timeline that defense modernization would basically be complete in 15 years time by 2035, that China will get into the top tier of world military powers. And then 15 years after that, by 2050, by the 100th anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic of China, that China will become what they call a comprehensive world military power that will begin to rival whoever is the hegemon there. So this is by 2050, China will push the US to be the global dominant military power. And this is he's laid this out in the last few years. He reiterated this about a month ago at the annual National People's Congress, where they came out with a number of new medium and long term plans to reiterate that these targets are key. Next slide. To be able, in terms of military strengthening, to develop those capabilities, a lot of it is looking at developing traditional military capabilities, those in the naval sphere or for traditional air power or for more limited in terms of ground and force capabilities. But a lot more of what they're doing is Xi Jinping wants to have a military that is prepared not to fight necessarily today's war, but tomorrow's war. And what he talks about is not even tomorrow's war, but the wars of tomorrow's tomorrow. And so there's this focus on, right now it's on informationization, and now they're talking about intelligentization, about of using artificial intelligence, using quantum communications, using big data, using a lot of these these emerging technologies, both emerging software, etc., to try to leapfrog ahead not just one, but two or three stages itself. And trying to sort of have a lot of these AI capabilities, these high performance computer capabilities, all very much linked in and sort of connected, and to be able to deal with external but also domestic national security risks. Next slide. An important part of all this is how do you fuse, how do you integrate both the civilian and the military portions of the Chinese system, because much of the innovation, of the dynamism that the military needs comes in the civilian realm itself, where it's where market competition is much more active. There's much more linkages with the global innovation system. So how do you bring all that in? So there's that part itself in terms of fusing the cutting edge emerging tech technologies. There's also the conventional and strategic defense industrial bases of how do you build high-end offensive capabilities, whether it's aircraft carriers or hypersonic capabilities or space-based systems, etc. Or these whole toolkit of inferior military power taking on a more superior power that the Chinese fear that they're dealing with the US, developing these anti-access area denial capabilities itself. And so there's a lot of these types of capacity building, investing in new foundations of technological capabilities that are still we're not clear where it's going. We don't know where AI or quantum or high performance can come in. But the Chinese authorities are willing to make big bets now and over the next decade or so. Next slide. And so in terms of military civil fusion, it's in a wide range of areas itself. It's about human talent cultivation, science and technology, critical infrastructure, logistics, and quarter matters so supplies, as well as mobilization in crisis situations. Next slide. So next slide. So the last part, what I want to spend the last few minutes is, having explained what's going on in China, it's the important part is, so comparing what the Chinese are doing with what the US is doing itself. This is a very busy slide, but what I've done, this is part of a book that will come out next year, is to develop a framework to be able to compare what is going on in the Chinese techno security state, what are the key factors, etc., and comparing apples to apples of what is going on in the US, because the US has many of these components of a techno security state. And to be really able to understand and to compare, this race to see who is ahead or who has the momentum and will will take over, we need to compare things the nature of their governance regimes itself, the nature of the role of the state. As I mentioned, on the Chinese side, it's a very top-down statist approach. And that's very, very good, especially in crisis situations or when things are changing very quickly. The US, its technosecurity state is very much of an anti-status, of a very much of a bottom-up approach encouraging economic development and military development. So what you have are two technosecurity states, but who are very, very different in nature. And it's only when we look at the nature of their economic system, the nature of the relationship between the state and various parts of the techno-security lineup, how these techno-security states link in with other countries around the world. Only when we compare those together will we have a much more balanced and rigorous understanding to be able to say, well, the next decade or two, this is where we see where China and the US is going in that way. So I will end it here, and I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you, Dr. Cheung. So we move into the question and answer portion of the session now. So for all of our viewers out there, you can type questions into the questions tab, and we'll be able to ask Dr. Cheung. And while we gather some of those, I'll ask the first question. Part of the technological advances you mentioned are things like AI, fusion, high performance computing. Mm-hmm. And I'm just curious, especially with China's state run top down versus the US bottom up, if China is successful in developing these technologies, how long of a window do they really have to capitalize on them? And I ask because if we look in the United States, right, I think the COVID vaccine is instructive there, right? We dedicated a lot of time and research to rolling out a vaccine in less than a year, right? During the Cold War and the space race, you know, it was very state driven. We put a man on the moon. So if the US does have to catch up and has to kind of switch production and a focus production, how much time does the Chinese government have to take advantage of these things?
So, that's a great question. I mean, it's becoming sort of a world-class sort of frontier lead in technology or a technology security state requires sort of massive investments over long periods of time. Because, I mean, to be able to sort of do research and development and produce at the highest levels, to do things that other countries have not do, you need to have world-class universities to be able to provide and train the top-class talent, and also to do the research. You need to have the various mechanisms, the state, the investment mechanism, to be able to drive a lot of this, etc. And so what we've seen is the US has been investing a long time in in its innovation ecosystem, right? And so the US is over the last 60 years, since the end of the Second World War, has invested significantly and sustain amounts from the Cold War, even in the post-Cold War era. A lot of that has been legacy systems, but it's but the US, in terms of its innovation, it's world-class and it's at the very, very top. China has only really been serious about investing on innovation and science and technology since the beginning of the 21st century. So China's been it's a relatively latecomer. Relatively new. It's only had been around in terms of focusing on science and technology innovation 20 years. And so what we see is that, but the Chinese are very hungry, and under Xi Jinping, they can mobilize and focus what the capabilities are to big bets, etc. So the Chinese are catching up, and the Chinese have the momentum, and so the gap is closing in a select number of areas. But if you look overall, the US is still very much at the top, etc. The whole question is, can the US overcome resting on its achievements, focusing on new breakthrough areas rather than legacy systems, etc. So the US is very much in the lead, and it's for it to lose itself. And what we've seen is that the Biden administration, building upon the Trump administration, they finally woken up to the China challenge here, etc. And I think their timing is important, because if the US didn't really mobilize at this time and left it for another five or more years, the Chinese would have been able to narrow that gap more. Of course, we will see though if the US once it's woken up, will it actually be able to, because of the nature of divided government, the economic sort of constraints that it finds itself in the post-pandemic era. Is it really able to invest in these critical areas to meet the challenge that the Chinese are doing itself?
Great, thank you. To build on that a little bit, I'll draw from some audience questions. Do you think that there's any areas in particular that the Chinese believe that they are already advanced and beyond the United States? And is there any areas for cooperation and collaboration on technology between the US and China?
Okay, I mean, that's a great sort of question. I mean, there are a few pockets that the Chinese see themselves as sort of as being in a sort of whether it's in front or neck to neck or just closely behind the US's. I mean, first of all, the only issue is like sometimes it's comparing apples to oranges, right? So in AI, there's a lot of discussion among sort of AI experts like, well, the Chinese seem to be sort of very much on top. The Chinese are very sort of in advance in things like AI, in the actual application. The Chinese are very good at collecting data, and making commercial applications and rolling that out into surveillance capabilities. When you look at in terms of research, the Chinese are sort of still significantly behind in terms of the quality of research, in terms of the quality of products. The Chinese are also very good less in terms of the high quality research, but more in fielding capabilities in areas like hypersonics, in quantum communications, in the good enough parts of drone technology, in missiles, etc., especially anti-ship ballistic missiles. So there's these growing areas that the Chinese, especially in these emerging sectors, that the Chinese are making strong moves. And if you have a look, I mean, the 14th five-year plan that came out about a month ago, the Chinese have laid out around 9 areas where they said we're making really big bets in these areas that we want to take the leadership on over the next 5 to 10 years. A lot of in things like in deep space, in deep underwater domains, etc., also on nuclear, etc. So the Chinese are now expanding the aperture in terms of the areas that there's this window of opportunity that it needs to take. So that's the first question. What was the second question? The second part. Sorry.
Is there any room for cooperation or collaboration between the United States and China on technological growth?
Okay. Yes. I mean, it's very very narrow. I mean, there's areas like climate change that allows it. But the problem both on the Chinese side and on the U.S. side is that the definition of of national security and the nature of the threat has become increasingly expansive itself. So it's anyone wanting to engage in technology cooperation on both sides faces a very very difficult political environment. I mean, one area that would have been obvious for cooperation was in the bio and pharmaceutical areas, right? So there should have been cooperation on developing a COVID vaccine. So in the healthcare area where there's shared human interest, but as we've seen, that became increasingly securitized. And so that become a radioactive area. I mean, it has to be areas where there's no strategic or military vulnerabilities, etc. And when you look at how the Chinese are viewing this, the Chinese are increasingly pulling away, and everything they see the US doing in terms of sanctions, in terms of technology embargoes, the Chinese have said, well, we can't really play cooperation with the US. And so they've turned more to the Russians and other sort of allies. And the US, they've been ramping up sort of their export controls, and it's like every month the entities list that's put out by the Commerce Department, it gets longer and longer with Chinese companies and with Chinese individuals. So this is so the number of areas that there's cooperation on in technology is very, very limited these days and shrinking.
Great, thank you. And one of the things you just mentioned is that there is potential cooperation over a COVID vaccine or an approach to COVID. Do you think that the Chinese government is going to use this outbreak in a way to consolidate power over the domestic population and focus on biotechnologies?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, biotech technology is one of those areas where the Chinese are emphasizing itself. And when you look at sort of how the Chinese responded to the COVID pandemic itself, I mean, there's different perspectives. But one is, it's almost like on the U.S. side as well. There was a very militarized response that it's like the Chinese said is like, well, it's like we have this outbreak. It happened in Wuhan and it spread to sort of the surrounding area of Hubei. And so what the Chinese did is like they said, we have a top-down authoritarian system that allows us to crack down and sort of and to deal with any crisis by pouring lots and lots of resources in. And so the Chinese took what they call a people's war approach to dealing with the pandemic. And so what they did is they cracked down and they controlled and they ensured domestic stability through a lot of their coercive means. At the same time, they mobilized their research and development apparatus, especially the military portions, and also on the commercial portions through military civil fusion to develop health risk responses, vaccines or testing or PPE capabilities. So the when you read sort of the assessments by Chinese leaders and Chinese analysts, they say it's like the Chinese response to the COVID crisis, whether it's through healthcare issues or research and development or mobilization of the state, it's like China was very, very successful at that. So that's sort of another sort of a tick in terms of this techno-security state that Xi Jinping has built on.
Thank you. One of my colleagues in the history department, Dr. Kim, noted that it's the 50th anniversary of the beloved video game, the Oregon Trail. And she was struck by the fact that popular video games and military recruitment videos are changing, and Chinese and US are kind of converging to something much more similar and starting to look much more alike. How important do you think entertainment media industries will be in being a site or a laboratory for technologies that have potential for military implications?
Mm-hmm. There may be some similarities, but I would say they're pretty surface level similarities, right? I mean, it's like, there's different dimensions here. One is, both on the US and on the Chinese side, there's these notions of patriotism, of nationalism. What you get on helps to cultivate parts of the population, especially some of the youth, and the Chinese do it from a state organized perspective, while on the US side it's much more of a bottom up. So what you get on the Chinese side is a much more top down state controlled approach to of nationalism and how that spills over into mobilization, social mobilization, development of of films or social media or video games. Unfortunately, I don't play any video games, so I have no idea on that. But it's like a lot of the tenants there on the Chinese side is driven by the state. So it's very orchestrated and very controlled. on the US and in the West. Yes, there's a lot of sort of the militarization of the video games. You get a sort of a lot sort of like of the military dimension in popular media itself. But a lot of that is sort of the state has very little control of that. That is sort of that's the role of the marketplace, sort of the role of competition and bottom up, etc. So what you get is a much more different, much more nuanced approach. So what we see is in terms of the soft dimension of the social media, of these different dimensions, is similar to what we see in terms of the two techno-security states. One is this authoritarian, top-down, state-driven approach to the soft power dimensions. And then on the US side, it's very much of a bottom-up, sort of a market-driven approach. But at the same time, both of these two societies and the elites that drive them see themselves as great powers, as competing for the commanding heights of the global system.
Thank you. And can I ask you to pull a little bit on the spillover effect that you talk about, especially within China, where it's this top-down approach, but still technology tends to diffuse among the population. And as technology grows and people have more access to it, it makes life easier, it makes things more affordable, a middle class starts to grow, and naturally a middle class starts to demand more political rights. So right. How does China manage that kind of spillover of these technological advances?
So that was sort of like the optimistic view sort of technology as this sort of great democratic force that people had, especially for China, sort of in the 1990s and 2000s, right? As the internet comes on, as sort of like as barriers to information sort of gets challenged in China, it would be seen that the Chinese population sort of would be able to overcome a lot of these constraints and hold on power that the Chinese authorities, especially the commerce system, which has always sort of been a step behind itself. But the Chinese authorities were very, very savvy. They said, well, we can sort of like either give up, as a lot of countries have done, and sort of let the internet sort of like the marketplace, let the bottom up forces sort of take charge. Well, we can sort of look at and design our own sort of like information internet sort of control system. And when you look at sort of the nature of the Chinese internet, the nature of social media, of the role of sort of the corporate interests in China, it's radically different than what we see in the US. It's very, very difficult for people to sort of get across the great firewall of China now. The authorities, they have very much sort of like made sure that all the big social media companies, whether it's Tencent, or Baidu and all these others, they are very much sort of under the control, and their ability to make money is dependent on them very, very carefully and towing the party line, etc. So the Chinese authorities sort of have been able, instead of sort of seeing the information system, the information age, and sort of the internet as sort of like as a threat, they've seen it as an opportunity, and so very much sort of like and leveraged sort of the internet system, the technology. To serve the party as opposed to oppose the party itself. And that sort of like, and it's that control is almost total these days. I mean, occasionally you get new technologies that come up that tries to circumvent sort of this great firewall, et cetera, but they get smacked down very, very quickly. And so to today, there's no optimistic sort of democratic vision of technology that might transform China. It's very much sort of like how technology can be sort of even better applied for authoritarian state to maintain and deepen its control.
Thank you. That's gloomy. One of our audience members wants to pull us out of the state a little bit and ask, what can international institutions like the United Nations and World Trade Organization do to ensure China's technological growth tends to align with global norms?
I mean, that's another very good question. I mean, and a lot of this, what we see today is that there's this great sort of effort or also a great game underway about who gets to design the norms of the future sort of global technology and innovation order, right? And so the Chinese sort of in the last few years, they've become very sort of attentive to sort of these international institutions, such as those in charge of sort of determining what the next standards are for things like 5G, et cetera, or for intellectual property rights, like which UN organizations that are in charge of sort of drawing up sort of the rules of the game for the internet, for cyber security, and all those. And the Chinese are sort of very much putting resources in to sort of to take leadership in norm building, in standards building. The US has been pushing back on this itself. I mean, we see sort of a great example was that was this big battle about who would get in charge of the UN agency in charge of intellectual property rights, etc. And the US, given the issues of the last of 4 years under the Trump administration, where they didn't really sort of see themselves as sort of as part of participation with other countries sort of in dealing with a lot of these issues, the Chinese were able to make major inroads. So the U.S. like on the intellectual property rights sort of panel, they scrambled to eventually to prevent the nomination of a Chinese to be in charge. But we are getting more and more in a growing number of areas of where the Chinese and the US are going neck to neck over who gets to become in charge of these bodies. And this is part of this more global technosecurity rivalry itself, because like in cybersecurity, the Chinese are pushing very much its motto. And a lot of countries, especially developing countries, are getting a lot of sort of access to Chinese resources, and they sort of and they support the Chinese thinking about this. And so, I mean, the really important sort of battlefront in terms of this great power competition in the technosecurity realm between the U.S. and China is over who gets to build the bigger, more qualitative alliances that maintains their overall control over the global order itself. And the competition here is really ramping up.
Thank you. Is there any way that, is there anything more that can be done to stop Chinese intellectual property theft?
The US and other countries have been doing as much as they can. At the end of the day, it's like, I mean, if governments or regimes want to sort of engage in intellectual property theft, and they use the instruments of state to do that, it's very, very difficult, because you can do this for cyber means, for traditional espionage, or for other areas. I mean, at the end of the day, a country by itself, they have to decide that intellectual property theft is not in their interest. And so you can see, when you look at how countries have evolved for economic development, right? I mean, in the 1960s and 1970s, the biggest intellectual property thefts were by countries like Japan, by South Korea, and then by Taiwan, etc. But as they move up the levels of economic development, as they move from stealing intellectual property to now inventing intellectual property, etc., then the institutional culture, the innovation culture of that state then evolves. This has happened previously to other countries as well. So the hope is that China also goes through this stage of development. That is like stealing intellectual property is a quick high. It gets you forward quite quickly, but the long-term side effects are not very good, because why would anyone want to invest if you can't trust your own innovation system? So that's the fundamental way that China will move from becoming a stealer of intellectual property to be one of the major protectors of intellectual property. But that's sort of in the general realm itself. But in terms of on the security realm, I mean, the Chinese have found it so successful to engage on whether it's cyber espionage or through traditional espionage. It's like, and they built a whole technology development system based upon the ability to be able to steal. But also, I mean, a lot of what they do is it's quite legitimate. They buy and they reverse engineer itself.
Great, thank you. And I think we have maybe two or three more minutes for one last question. So how does China's technological growth affect their global influence, especially among developing states? The ability to provide advanced technology can increase the attractiveness of global investment and development, even when it's not beneficial for the host state. So how do the United States and other Western powers head off China's global technological reach? And sorry, in only a couple minutes, I know. So it's a big question with not a lot of time.
This is one of those big questions, right? I mean, it's like right now, it's if you look at sort of the trade and investment statistics, companies still want to go to China. China is still sort of like a net gainer of foreign investment in tech technology, and so even at the same time as sort of China is becoming crucially worried, become dependent on these critical technologies like semiconductors, and other areas that the U.S. is cracking down on, the Chinese see that as like given its domestic market, and given the appeal of its supply chains, it's trying to draw in more and more foreign companies before the potential for decoupling between the U.S. and China, and between the West and the Chinese model begins to grow in ever greater momentum. So what the Chinese are doing is that they're saying come more. So they want more and more foreign firms, especially advanced foreign firms, to move a significant portion of their technology research, development, production capability into the Chinese system. So what you get in the end is that it's a very messy system where the US and China wants to decouple, but around the rest of the world, it's like countries and companies are trying to sort of maintain a balance, having one foot in both camps itself. And that's going to be one of the fascinating trajectories as we move forwards.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Cheung. We really appreciate you taking the time and your insights. I know I had a lot more questions, but we had some excellent questions from the audience, so we weren't able to get to them all. But I want to thank you. I want to thank our audience for paying attention and providing some questions. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Dr. Koo to close out the session.
Okay. Thank you, Michael.
Once again, Dr. Cheung, thank you so much for your spirited talk and answers to a lot of questions. And Dr. Michael Thunberg, thank you so much for your just a nice moderator role. Audience, I really appreciate your participation in today's summit sessions. The Peace and World Virtual Summit, like last sessions, will be held next Wednesday. So next day, Wednesday, 1 p.m., Ms. Cherry Cuddy at the U.S. Department of Energy will address the issue of U.S.-China cybersecurity. And then 3 p.m., Dr. Bryce Barrows at German Marshall Fund and Mr. Peter Marino at New School for Social Research will talk about Chinese interferences in democracies. Hope many of you can join next Wednesday, the last summit sessions as well. Thank you so much again, and have a nice week.